Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we will be discussing the news item that appeared in different newspapers. Today we will be discussing 15 topics in total. Of them, 8 are in the perspective of prelims. And the remaining 7 are in the perspective of mains. The first topic is about Vishwashanti Ahimsa Sammelan that was organized in Maharashtra. This article appeared in PIB. Normally in prelims paper, a question on Buddhism or Jainism is compulsory. We have been witnessing it for the past 4-5 years. Now, any news item that appearing in PIB also becomes more important. And if that news item is about Jainism, then it becomes more crucial for prelims. So, what is this Vishwashanti Ahimsa Sammelan? Conference is being organized by the Jain community in order to bring in Vishwa Shanti, that is world peace through Ahimsa. Ahimsa is one of the important virtues professed by Jainism. Mahavira, the 23rd Tirthankara of Jainism, he gave importance to aparigraha, that is not taking what is more than essential to live. In a layman terms, aparigraha may be explained as not to steal. As far as the Jainism is concerned, their basic principle is Ahimsa Paramo Dharma. What is that? Ahimsa, non-violence, is the highest of all virtues. The modern world is defined by ruthless consumption and accumulation of resources by humankind. This increasing consumerism has brought more impact on our environment. And it has also changed the moral virtues of the individuals. In this context, following the principles of Ahimsa and Aparigraha becomes more imperative for humans' individual development. Next article is about Lal Bahadur Shastri Award for Public Administration. This article appeared in PIB. This particular award may be insignificant, but knowing about the person, that is Sri Lal Bahadur Shastri, becomes more important. He is one of the stalwarts of India's democracy. Lal Bahadur Shastri became India's second Prime Minister after the death of Jawaharlal Nehru in 1964. And he coined a famous phrase, Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. That is, he wanted to focus on the development of Indian army and Indian agriculture. He was the one who actually promoted green and white revolution in India, and apart from these successes, he also made India to win the war with Pakistan in 1965. And most important aspect for all the aspirants is that since he was a great stalwart in public administration and public service, considering his contribution to the public administration arena in India, the National Academy for Administrative Training has been named after Sri Lal Bahadur Shastri. The next topic is about inclusion of cross-border insolvency chapter in India's Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. UN CITROL, an organization under the ambit of United Nations, has a model law of cross-border insolvency, which was adopted in 1997. What is UN CITROL? UN CITROL is United Nations Commission on International Trade Laws. It was established in 1966 under UN General Assembly Resolution 2205. And this recommendations was studied by the Insolvency Law Committee. What is Insolvency Law Committee? It is a committee established by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. What is the role of Insolvency Law Committee? Their role is to recommend amendments to Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of India 2016. India has been marred with the exit challenge, that is the Chakravyuha challenge proposed by Economic Survey 2015-16. And this has got an impact on India's ease of doing business rankings. Now, the greater aim of the government is to improve the exit channel for the companies. In order to strengthen the exit possibilities for the companies, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of 2016 was launched, and this Insolvency Law Committee is aiming at imbibing greater confidence among the foreign investors and providing adequate flexibility for seamless integration with domestic insolvency law and robust mechanism for international cooperation. We have a robust domestic insolvency law now, and this domestic insolvency law should be in sync with UN CITRALS model law. The Insolvency Law Committee has submitted its second report to the government, which is titled Cross-Border Insolvency. The next article is about Hari Diwali, Swasth Diwali. How cutting down on cracker bursting during Diwali will improve our health. This is what the article is speaking about. This article has been taken from PIB. Diwali, the festival of lights, has evolved to become the festival of crackers, involving more pollution, creating more pollution, noise and air. The crackers normally contain few combustible chemicals, which includes potassium chlorate, powdered aluminium, magnesium, salts of barium, copper, sodium, lithium and strontium. And many of these are heavy metals and they have huge impact on human health. This initiative, this campaign Hari Diwali Swasth Diwali, is launched by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change to create awareness about the air pollution existing in northern part of India during winter period. In 2013, there was a question on e-waste in India, which listed 7 chemical compounds, and the aspirants were asked to choose the right compounds out of those 7. They may even ask about the crackers. So understand, knowing the chemicals being used in the crackers becomes more important. The next topic is about health and nutrition initiatives taken under Aspirational Districts Program. Aspirational Districts Program has been launched by the central government based on 3 C's. What are those 3 C's? Convergence, competition, and cooperation. 115 backward districts have been selected all over the country based on the criteria fixed by the Ministry of Rural Development, Niti Aayog, and Ministry of Home Affairs. And Ministry of Home Affairs is involved for the districts which are affected by the left-wing extremism. And the main aim of the scheme is to bring in convergence among the initiatives taken by the state and central governments. And for that, they have introduced a Prabhari officers, a joint secretary level in central government from the same state will work with the state government to bring in convergence among different schemes. Second is about competition. The 115 districts are ranked, delta ranked, based on their performance in key indicators, and based on their performance, based on the ranking, the best practices are outlined, and these best practices are followed by the other districts. Then cooperation among state and central government in different fronts. So this project is a classic example of cooperative and competitive federalism. Health is one of the important indicator under this aspirational district program. In order to augment this indicator, the government has launched e-Mitra mobile application. We may even get a question, the e-Mitra mobile application is related to, if at all they ask a question, the answer should be aspirational district program. What are the aims of aspirational district program under this health and nutrition criteria? One important criteria to assess health outcomes is maternal mortality rate. That is the number of female deaths for every 1 lakh live births. And it has come down significantly from 2011-13 period to 2014-16 period. It has been quantified to be a reduction of 22%. The government of India is aiming at building a new India by 2022. And it is a commitment to improve the key indicators of aspirational district. The key indicators include education, health, sanitation, and other important social capital indicators. The next article is about the controversial Migingo Island. This article appeared in The Hindu. Every year in UPSC prelims paper, we can expect a question based on geography that is related with the current events. It might have appeared in newspaper. Even last year we had two questions, 2018 prelims, we had two questions based on geography from current affairs. So where is this Migingo Island located? Migingo Island is located in Lake Victoria, and this Migingo Island is claimed both by Kenya and Uganda. The Lake Victoria is surrounded by three African countries. First is Tanzania, second is Kenya, and third is Uganda. The eastern part of African continent is marked with divergent plate tectonics. And this has resulted in a longest rift valley of the planet. This rift valley is marked with a number of lakes, and few of the lakes that lie in the rift valley are Lake Malawi, Lake Rukwa, Lake Tanganyika, Lake Kivu, Lake Edward, Lake Albert, Lake Turkana. And one most important point to be remembered is that Lake Victoria is not part of the rift valley lakes. I repeat, Lake Victoria is not part of this rift valley lakes. The next topic is about the widening of tax base in India and increasing tax compliance in India. The article has been taken from the PIB. In prelims paper under economic section, we can expect a question on the macroeconomic trends faced by the country in the past decade. In 2017, there was a question on direct tax collection of India in the past decade. So understanding the trend of macroeconomic development is more important for prelims perspective. So the Central Board of Direct Taxes has released the back series data including 2017-18 financial year. The key highlights of the released statistics are, the report says that direct tax to GDP ratio has been increasing in India for the past 3 years, and the value of the ratio is 5.98, and this is the best direct tax to GDP ratio in the past 10 years. Due to the persuasion and other measures taken by the government, there has been increased compliance under direct tax. The compliance has grown more than 80% in terms of number of returns filed in the last 4 financial years. It has increased from 3.79 crore income tax filers to 6.85 crores income tax filers between the years of 2013-14 to 2017-18. The number of persons filing return for income, it has also increased about 65% between the period 2013-14 to 2017-18. It has increased from 3.31 crore to 5.44 crore persons. And another important fact is that individual taxpayers whose income is above 1 crore has risen from 48,416 in the assessment year 15 to 81,344 in assessment year 2018. This shows the rising pay scales for Indian employees. These statistics indicate that the Indian economy has become formalized over the years, and the major factor to induce formalization in Indian economy has been the introduction of goods and service tax. What are the key outcomes of this report? For any government, tax is the base for undertaking developmental activities. Widening of tax base indicates that financial health of the government is in good state. The state of financial health is indicated by tax to GDP ratio, buoyancy factor, and the quantum of direct tax collection. The vital indicators of tax to GDP ratio, buoyancy factor, and direct tax collection are positive. Now it's time for the articles pertinent to mains. The first article is about the failure of India to address its urban slum problem. According to UN World Urbanization Prospects report, 34% of India's population now live in urban areas. These urban areas includes the proper settled pakka urban areas, slums, and other urban agglomerations. When we discuss about urban areas, we tend to speak about the mega-sized urban clusters. The mega-sized urban clusters are the one which has more than 50 lakh population. But the focus should be on the urban slums and the urban agglomerations. these two areas which have less than 50 lakhs population needs to be focused should be on the urban clusters which are which house less than 50 lakhs of human population in order to have a sustainable urban settlements. And this figure indicates the growing urban population in India. As far as the urban slum problem is concerned in India, the approach is from two different poles. The first approach is community-based approach, which is proposed by the maximalist urban planners. What do? They think that the community should be given the foremost importance and their livelihood should not be disturbed with, and the urban planning should be based on that particular view of not disturbing the existing communities. And the next mode of urban planning to eradicate urban slums is based on the culture of poverty principle proposed by Oscar Lewis, an anthropologist. This is relatable with the social Darwinism principle proposed by sociologists. That is, the people, they want to stay poor and they find solace in being poor. And this social and cultural characteristics has made responsible to perpetuate their poverty by themselves. What are the problems posed by urban slums in India? The urban slums are islands of poverty amidst ocean of prosperity. Being smaller in size comparing to the size of city, it has more density, and this high population density has caused greater insignificance as far as physical infrastructure is concerned. And the slums are concerned with poverty and lack of healthy environment. This creates low development of education and low availability of health services. This has impact on social infrastructure of the urban areas. Apart from this, following the principles based on the culture of poverty has led to ghettoization, that is, moving these slum dwellers out of city. For example, let's consider the case of Dharavi as mentioned in this particular article. Moving the people from Dharavi to the outskirts of Mumbai, to the suburban areas of Mumbai, would demean the employment opportunities of the residents of Dharavi. Apart from that, moving them from their place of birth, moving them from the place of their residence to some other place which is new to them, they tend to have no interaction with the people around them in their new settlement. This would lead to ghettoization. How the policy of India has been traversed from the years. During 1950s and 70s, there was one particular law passed in Maharashtra, that is Maharashtra Vacant Lands Act. This is a classic example for the policy imperative followed by India between 1950s and 70s. The period was signified with forced demolition. Slums were removed and the slum dwellers were relocated using force. This was an archaic phase of eradicating slums in India. Apart from this, India's own implicit deficiencies related with faltering rural economy and the nature of urban growth. India's rural areas are marked with seasonal unemployment. And post-globalization era, India has jumped from the primary to the tertiary sector without having a intermediate secondary sector. This has created scope for many unskilled jobs in urban areas. This phenomenon is termed as premature deindustrialization. The economic policy of the governments of India has created this dichotomy between the urban and rural areas. And the inland migration, which is the key for economic development in a country, has led to the burst of slums in urban areas of India. Another important policy learning should be taken from World Bank's slum upgradation program. This was launched in 1985, and the slum dwelling people, they were allowed to open slum dwellers cooperatives, and they were given with financial incentives in order to build their homes. And the third important policy imperative is from slum rehabilitation scheme, which was launched in the 1995, which involved private players on the board. And these private players, they built 300 square feet houses for the slum dwellers in Dharavi. What are the struggles faced by the government while rehabilitating the slum dwellers in India? The first one is about inadequate data and titles in the slum area. Apart from this, these slum areas, they form an important role in informal economy of an urban settlement. Also, the government is facing some failure in the fronts of taking the representatives of slums in board while discussing any development plans. And the third and most important aspect is lack of confidence among the slum dwellers over the government initiatives, because the houses being built for the cause of slum rehabilitation, they lack standard and quality. The author has recommended few solutions. What are those solutions? The first solution is that he wants the government to consider local economic, political and social factors. The second, and he wants the governments to study from the best practices followed in different parts of the world. He has recommended about the Ban Mekong project of Thailand and Kampung Improvement Program of Indonesia. But the author ends in a pessimistic tone that these two initiatives in Thailand and Indonesia, it was successful only because of high governance quality in those countries. But with India, where governance quality is already abysmal, it would allow municipalities to abandon their responsibilities. The next article is about the enormity of job challenge being faced by India. This article is taken from The Hindu. To undertake any public policy initiative, data is more crucial. And to counter the challenge of unemployment in India, we need coherent data sets on unemployment existing in India. Recently, the chief statistician of Government of India, CSO, he has mentioned that the data based on Employee Provident Fund is a measure of formalization of workforce, and it is no way represents the extent of job creation. That is, recently there were a few research articles published by the labor economists citing that the increasing base of Employee Provident Fund indicates increased job creation in the economy, but it only indicates the formalization of the workforce and not the new jobs being created in the economy. This is what this statement explains. NSSO used to release a periodic labor force survey, but for the past few years, there is no sign of releasing data under this periodic labor force survey, created a lack of proper data relating to unemployment in India. Apart from these official data surveys, there are also few other problems which indicates the menace of unemployment in India. One among them is unrest among farmers, and the second indicator, apart from the growing unrest among farmers, is the protests undertaken by the socially affluent communities like Jats, Patels and Marathas in different parts of the country for reservation in government jobs. This indicates the manifestation of crisis in India. A recent survey says that India's labor market has 10 to 12 million new entrants every year. Of them, 7 to 8 millions are moving out of agriculture. This data is corroborating with the data provided by Employment Unemployment Survey of National Sample Survey Organization undertaken between 2004-05 and 2011-12. This survey mentions that every year 7 million Indian people move out of agriculture seeking new avenues for employment. The challenge before the government is to create a healthy employment opportunities for this 7 to 8 million people moving out of agriculture every year. The annual surveys of Labour Bureau indicates that the agricultural labourers, they face a new variety of seasonal unemployment. They do undertake different other non-farm jobs in order to augment their income. The income from their agricultural occupation is not sufficient to run their life. This is corroborated by the pluriactivity confirmed from village surveys. What is pluriactivity? Pluriactivity is the phenomenon where an individual undertakes many jobs, many activities in order to attain economic self-sufficiency. The survey also indicates that almost 3/4 of the households have more than two occupations. What is the data proposed by Agricultural Census 2015-16? The census indicates that around 146 million operational agricultural holdings in the country, they have an average land holding of 1.08 hectares, which is very low comparing to peer economies. 86% of the operational holdings in India, they belong to the small and marginal holdings, which have less than 2 hectares. And the average size of this 86% of operational holdings is 0.6 hectares. Also, the major chunk of Indian labor force, that is around 100 million of the non-form informal sector employed people, they are juggling with multiple employments. The inconsistency in the employment opportunities available to them has made them to jump between different jobs to attain economic self-sufficiency. This infographics indicate the present state of agricultural laborers and farmers in India. In 2001, the number of farmers in India was around 12 crore 73 lakhs. Now it has come down to 11 crore 87 lakhs. And number of farm laborers in India in 2001 was 10 crore 67 lakhs. But now it has increased. The landlessness of the farmers have increased and it has resulted in number of farm laborers increasing in 2011. The number of farm laborers is now 14 crore 43 lakhs. This agrarian crisis is caused by dwindling land, climate change and less profits in farming. The persisting economic conditions in the country with the persisting social conditions has resulted in cumulative failure of job creation in India. The government should act proactively in order to address this cumulative failure. The government should take a step forward to provide a gainful and secure form of employment. The author concludes by saying that this problem of unemployment in India is essentially caused by the model of growth which we have followed the last three decades. This model of growth has prioritized profits over wages, non-farm sector over farm sector, and capitalists over workers. The next article is about India's twin surplus problem. This article appeared in Mint newspaper. HSBC, in a recent report, has projected that India's GDP value would be around $5.9 trillion by 2030. This is far less than the amount projected by Niti Aayog. Niti Aayog has projected that by 2032, the value of India's GDP would be around $10 trillion. In order to achieve the aspiration set by Niti Aayog, India has to invest more in social capital. But this imperative is contradicted by the government's move to refuse the Human Capital Index of World Bank. India has been ranked 115th out of 157 countries in the report. Government of India has rejected this report because the report had ignored many transformational initiatives. But this low ranking of India indicates the low productivity of Indian economy. World Bank was right in indicating the low productivity in India. The author has suggested that India is a productivity challenged nation because it is an attitude challenged nation. The author is suggesting to change the attitude of Indian policymakers in order to improve the productivity of India. So, what do we need to improve our productivity? Whenever we say the word productivity, what comes into your mind? It is infrastructure. There are two types of infrastructures. One is soft and another is hard. Hard is the physical infrastructures like road, water and energy systems. Whereas the soft infrastructure is based on social capital. It is more important to focus on India's soft infrastructure problem, which is the second component of infrastructure which we explained now. this problem reflects our workplace attitudes in India. In India, the focus is more on high strain jobs, which involves no or low technology. This is caused by the underinvestment in technology. To explain it in other terms, there is an authority without any responsibility or accountability. This authority is not responsible for the outcomes, and this has led to the high strain on others. This has created the scope for high strain jobs in India. The author says that India's workplace problems are mainly on India's policy making in general, affected by a twin surplus problem. This twin surplus includes big egos and small minds. The best example for this twin surplus problem is the Right to Education Act, where more importance was given to the infrastructural facilities, that is the physical infrastructural facilities in the school, and less importance was given to the quality of educational outcomes. This indicates the menace of twin surplus problem in India. India's productivity challenge is in part it's due to its inability to produce in scale. We lack manufacturing in economy of scale. This lagging in manufacturing in economy of scale and lack of social capital has created a unique problem for India. Now, the HSBC has projected that with the present economic situation, India could reach only the GDP value of $5.9 trillion by 2030. In order to achieve the $10 trillion mark set by Niti Aayog, the government should focus more on improving social capital of the country. The next article is about the situation created by toilets in urban Uttar Pradesh. A recent survey undertaken by Center for Science and Environment has suggested that urban Uttar Pradesh has 80% coverage of toilet, but inefficient sanitation systems has ensured that almost 87% of the excreta generated by these toilets is dumped in water bodies or agricultural lands. This is mainly due to the on-site sanitation systems like septic tank or pit latrines. This has a greater impact on the environment and health of the people. Apart from this, this also leads to another social stigma called manual scavenging. The survey suggests that building more toilets without any proper mechanism to treat the excreta coming out of the toilets will worsen the environmental, sanitation and manual scavenging situation in the country. How can we address this problem? Sewerage connection should increase from the current 28% of the households. What should be the solution to this problem? The survey was undertaken in households of 30 cities. The sewerage connections in those 30 cities were only 28%, and it should be increased, and scientific management of sewerage is required in order to contain the menace of swampification of Uttar Pradesh water bodies. The next article is about the need for prison reform in India. This article appeared in The Hindu. Supreme Court last month had formed an expert committee on prison reforms. The committee was headed by the former Supreme Court Judge Justice Amitava Rai. Apart from this, there were two earlier committees to undertake reforms or prison reforms. The first committee was headed by Justice A.N. Mulla, and the second committee was headed by Justice Krishna Iyer. Justice Krishna Iyer committee was looking into the conditions of women prisoners in India. So this infographic indicates the demographic profile of prison inmates in India. Of the total prison inmates in India, the convicts form around 1.34 lakhs and the under trials are very high. This high number of under trials in Indian prison indicates the slow movement of Indian judiciary and pendency of cases in Indian judiciary. So what is the need for introducing reforms to Indian prisons? Indian prisons is marred with overcrowding. The average occupancy rate of Indian prisons are around 114%. The number of prisoners in India or more than what the prisons could house. The inmates number is around 4.2 lakhs. the density of prisoners in India is high as far as the prisons are concerned with. And as I mentioned earlier about the under trials are increasing in number, and this indicates the pendency in Indian judiciary. The punitive actions undertaken by the state should be focusing on reformation and rehabilitation, but rather the punishments given by the law of the land now is focusing more on retribution. Retributive justice, which is following the lines of Hammurabi, has no place in a postmodern world. The author has used the example of the clemency plea filed by the convicts of Rajiv Gandhi assassination case. There is also the increasing incidence of white collar crimes in India. Instead of jailing them, the white collar crimes can be dealt with heavy fines and other financial means. The jails, instead of being a place for reformation, they become a place for building connection between different illegal elements. This, along with lack of rehabilitation measure to constructively engage the inmates after their release, has led to the failure of prisons in India. Even a criminal is a human. They should be treated with dignity, and they should be treated with their basic human needs. Considering the regard for their basic human needs, prisoners must be handled with dignity in order to avoid custodial deaths. The next article is about the worsening situation of financial inclusion in the villages. This is based on a survey undertaken by NABARD. NABARD is National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. It has released a report titled All India Rural Financial Inclusion Survey 2016-17. This report indicates the worsening situation of farmers in villages across India. NABARD was started in 1982 under the recommendation of Sivaraman Commission. What were the findings of the survey? The survey suggested that the agricultural households, they get only 43% of their income from their primary agricultural activities such as agriculture and animal husbandry. The other source of their income, while the remaining part of their household income, is from wage labor. The salaries from the government for the rural families, rural households, includes the salary paid under the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. Agricultural households gain only 43%, but the rural households get hardly 23% of their income from agriculture and allied activities. The normal perception in policy making is that the rural households are always equated with agricultural households, but this survey indicates that there is a widening gap between what we understand as rural households and what a rural household actually is. This data shows a meagerness of income from agriculture even in rural areas. Okay, what are the initiatives undertaken by the government to improve the farm income? First and foremost, the government has the target to double the farm income of farmers by 2022. This target is aiming at improving the income of 48% of rural population involved in agriculture as their primary economic source. Also, in order to improve their farm income, the government has increased the MSP for kharif crops by at least 50%. Economic Survey 2017-18 has mentioned that increasing irrigation costs and the climate change would have impact on the unirrigated lands. So, through Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana, irrigation facilities can be improved. The cost of farm inputs like seeds, fertilizers can be brought down. So far, the government had extended the Kisan credit card only to the farmers involved in primary agriculture. Rather, it was not to the allied activities of agriculture like animal husbandry and fishing. Now, in the recent budget, the Kisan credit card has been extended to the farmers involved in animal husbandry and fishing. Organic farming not only has nutritive values, also it has economic values. It has huge export potential. Apart from increasing the income of farmers, it has also the potential to improve the trade surplus of India. So more attention to organic farming under Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana has to be undertaken. Also, the government is encouraging agroforestry in India. What is agroforestry? Agroforestry is growing trees along with agricultural crops, which has a widespread impact on reducing soil erosion, maintaining soil quality. The next article is about the declining land productivity in India. This article appeared in Indian Express. In a recent report submitted by the Indian government to United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification, reveals that many states are witnessing changes in land productivity due to various factors. First, we have to understand what is UNCCD and what is the objective of UNCCD. UNCCD is aiming at combating desertification in countries experiencing serious droughts and desertification, and to mitigate the effects of drought. What are the principles based on which UNCCD works? Implementation, participation and cooperation by all the stakeholders. Improvement of partnership and coordination on both local and international levels. Special consideration for the least developed countries. The report has mentioned that land productivity of nearly 1 lakh square kilometers of area in India has declined or was under stress due to recent such as deforestation, over-exploitation. UNCCD is the custodian agency for Sustainable Development Goal indicators related to degraded land. SDG 15 is focusing on the life above land. That is, it includes biodiversity of animals and crops. Desertification has a widespread impact on biodiversity of animals and plants. India had agreed to provide a report to UNCCD on the status of land productivity in India. Under UNCCD, the countries are striving to improve the condition of affected ecosystems, combat desertification, land degradation, promoting sustainable land management, and to contribute to land degradation neutrality. Land degradation neutrality is one of the foremost aim under UNCCD. In 2014, India had agreed to become land degradation neutral by 2030. According to this report, deforestation and over-exploitation were the two important reasons for declining land productivity in India. Based on these values, four states are considered to be the hotspots of declining land productivity in India. They are Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra and Karnataka. In Rajasthan, in the Aravalli range shows severe degradation in the quality of grasslands. In Gujarat, due to the existing drought-like conditions in Saurashtra, there is crop losses. Also in Maharashtra, the drought-like situations has caused losses in croplands. Karnataka has witnessed the wrath of deforestation. The tree cover losses in Western Ghats has reduced the productivity of lands in Karnataka. Thank you.